wife and I don't look on. All right.
They just shipped it. It should be here by the 10th.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to San Bernardino Valley College's performance of A New Day. There will be one 15-minute intermission. Video, audio, and picture taking of any kind is strictly prohibited. Please, at this time, turn off all electronic devices. Thank you, and enjoy the performance.
In a little cafe, just the other side of the border. He was sitting there giving me looks that make my mouth water.
Somewhere.
SBVC students are creative. SBVC students are a waste of oxygen.
Say,
SBVC students are idiots. SBVC students are ghetto.
Myself sometimes.
sometimes I have to deal with, yeah, you're in the musical, right? Where is it at? Right there. Valley College. You say it kind of subtle, to the point where you feel almost kind of embarrassed.
My addiction's trying to become the exact opposite of San Bernardino. But while trying to become different, I became exactly what San Bernardino is.
So there was this one girl who had her phone snatched right out of her hand while waiting at the bus stop. It's definitely one of those romance red flags. Yeah, maybe we should stay together and kind of watch each other's backs. Well, there's that. Although, I almost feel like you could expect that anywhere, really.
I mean, it's all right. I've never been somewhere else, so I don't know how other people judge it, but I like it here. I just like how the community is. I don't know why people think San Bernardino's ghetto and everything, because I've been here my whole life, and all I see is good people.
I got in the mindset. I want to go to a big school and do a lot of these big things, but it was expensive, and my dad got laid off, so it's like, can't really.
So there's these kids that are running around, so I decided, like, come on, let me show you what we do around here, walk you through this process. It's very easy and simple. And a lot of them could do it, like a lot of drug dealers. Hey, students.
Go to school? For what? Look, baby, I'm making $8,000 a day. Tell me to go to school, waste my time. You know, time is money. Why should I even go to school?
Because you're gonna go to jail. You're gonna go to jail, and it's just a matter of time. Somebody's gonna get mad and jealous. You know, dope dealers out here compete with each other. Now they're killing each other. For what? All about what? This ain't none of your territory, and you don't own nothing around here. You get what I'm saying?
I feel like that's the trippiest thing. I can get on the bus every morning and not see the difference between the borders. Our people in Redlands, with so much time on their hand, propagate these lies. Just so they think they're the ones who could point the finger out and say, look at them!
Look how bad it is. Look how ghetto they are!
Oh, man. I'm so glad I'm not there.
You're telling me.
My grandma,
She graduated here a long time ago. Nursing school, too. They're both RNs now. But they stayed. They're here.
But Valley? I love Valley. Because they help.
But a lot of people do not want it. They want to get out. It's almost like people just forget where they come from really quick. It's almost like they're ashamed.
So me and my step-sister-in-law, we were driving down the street, and there was this one guy who was riding a bike, and he looked kind of hippie-ish. Let's see. He had a blonde beard. Oh, and he had a parrot on his shoulder. We were just so distracted that we nearly got into a car accident. A legitimate parrot on this guy's shoulder, just riding his bike. That's the kind of thing that just sticks into my mind when I think of past experiences here in San Bernardino. It's like, oh, there was that one time with the man with the parrot.
I don't know where that comes from. When it comes to Valerie, I don't know if it's because, you know, anybody really can come to Valerie. You don't have to be special or have all these God-given talents, even though you can accumulate them while you're here. I just don't think that Valerie's been put on the map quite yet. I think that's definitely it.
Man, I don't know. Stop touching me.
I would rather my father be a serial killer rather than a rapist. Not because death is better than being raped, molested, or fondled. It's just, you never really get over the thing, you know? I mean, I should know. My father is my mother's cousin, and I've been molested since I can remember, raped through all those years. And just when I thought I escaped, I was raped again at a party.
Yeah, bad things happen. But I guess that's the minority here. I guess that's what the media tries to push on us. I've seen nothing but good people here. I remember there was all gang stuff happening around here. That only lasted a few months. Then the community got good. Some tragedy happens, there's people to back up. You're not alone here.
I don't care much about what other people think of me. I used to have this girlfriend and she went to UCR. So I know that the people at UCR aren't that different from the people at Valley. And I know that the people at UCLA aren't that different from the people at Valley either. Yeah, I went to UCLA for a little bit. They're all like this.
UCLA! You say that, mate! Fight, fight, fight!
Yeah. It's funny because some of the kids that used to say, well, fuck Valley, I see them walking around here. They're like, I go to UCLA. And I'm like, okay.
Come on, girl, do you even know?
You know what?
Of course you do.
All these things happen at these campuses, like UCLA.
UCLA!
Berkeley.
Go Bears!
And some other places around here. All these things happen at these colleges because all these things, they just happen in life in general.
Yeah, you know, it's all about circumstance. That's all it is.
I can do good here. And if I want more education, I can just go to university. They have a lot of things to help people here. It doesn't make sense not to go here. And it's near my house.
Your home. It all starts there. Because it starts with the parent. Literally. It's what I think. And you have parents who know the morals and principles and how important they are to bestow them on their offspring, but some don't because they don't care and—
But San Bernardino is my family. We are the drug addicts.
The drug addicts!
And the prostitutes. expected to become more of a high instead of something just pleasing. We look for an escape outside of San Bernardino. And I know I should be happy I'm not a slave, but I am one, stuck in the mindset of ongoing pain and fear just being passed around like it's normal. And there's nothing we can do about it.
So then, you have this kid. They grew up with all the morals. And then you have these kids that grew up not to give a damn.
Fuck off.
And now these kids are bullying these kids, so that these kids either give in to doing the same. It's like it monopolizes among the youth, and they're the next thing that comes up. Then it goes. It's just like a repetition of destruction.
When I'm in San Bernardino,
I feel like I'm trapped in the Walking Dead. I see faces that I once knew, wearing many different masks of hopelessness.
I feel the blood dried on the concrete,
like my skin when I come out of the pissy pools.
When I'm
in San Bernardino,
I see the matrix of greatness, except no one
told either pill because
they
overdosed
the American dream that they didn't dream, but were wrongfully born into. When I'm in San Bernardino, I
see prostitute cousins
high on my lack of income and unpaid bills, while teaching their daughters to be proud and independent women who don't need a man, because all they need is pussy is power.
When I'm in San Bernardino,
I feel the chains amongst my people's necks as they choke at bullets from their own brothers' guns, while not being their brother's keeper becomes a sad.
Other nations can unite and build,
while we destroy anything close to our own culture. When I'm in San Bernardino, I hear the cries of the people of Christ, hung up on the cross and left to bleed out.
You know, I keep hearing how dangerous San Bernardino is, but whenever I'm here, nothing happens. Sure, I'll admit, it would be pretty scary to come out here at night, but as long as you have God and maybe a taser, there's nothing to be afraid of. A small city with such small people, with kind hearts and large souls. Coming to San Bernardino was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. The other towns and cities, they never looked at me. They didn't even know who I was. God bless the people of San Bernardino.
Everything's okay. hold on.
No. It's just, you don't know what it's like to be in a room full of people who dislike you.
Let's go through a loser.
Yeah, you just, come on.
I'm short.
It used to kill me inside, you know? But now, I'm just pushing back. You know? Now, I'm just pushing back.
Last night took a L, but tonight I bought back.
Talk with everybody. Here, it's a little harder to make friends or talk with someone. Because in Mexico, like, when you meet a new person, you're like, hola, ¿cómo estás? I mean, it's easier to talk with them. But here, like, if I try to talk with someone in Spanish or in English, they don't respond the way I expect. Like, you talk with someone. Oh, hi.
Hey.
How are you?
Doing fine.
It's a little hard to talk with someone who talks like that. I don't know where to find people who speak really long, how do you say, dialogue.
Last semester definitely felt like that community college year, where you went to class, you didn't really know anyone, you did the work, and that's pretty much it.
Yeah, it's changed, it's different. Some of it's still around the corner at the liquor store, this girl, she used to go,
you'd be happy coming from going to school, I'd be happy coming from school.
I said, baby, I go to Valley, and in my general area, we're having fun because it's enjoying. You can't make it like it's school and da-da-da-da-da, you know what I'm saying, because then maybe these kids done come out of 12 years of school, and then gotta go to college and school again. One time, I was living the moment. I was walking down, actually, this street right here. I think passing some houses, there was this homeless guy just sitting there with his dog. Then he started asking me for something to eat. And I was like, hey, if you want to come with me to Jack's or something, I'll buy you whatever. You know? We went on, and he was just, I don't know. First of all, it was very awkward because I don't know what to tell him, what to say. I don't know. It was just him talking. I remember he was talking about, I honestly don't remember what he was talking about, but I do remember he ordered something, and I paid for it. And we just went out saying, later. I remember he said he was glad he had someone to talk to. Because he hadn't talked to someone sincerely in a couple of years. Yeah, I was like, damn. I don't know, it hit me. And then his dog started following me. I remember he was following beside me. I was just telling him to go back to his owner. And he started to go back. He went back to the homeless guy. Yeah, I just went home after that.
Thank you.
Hi, I saw in my math class. I think that's the only way I can talk to people because outside in the cafeteria, somebody is sitting next to me. I don't know how to start a conversation with him or her. I just don't know how. But try to think what to say. Maybe the conversation is going to go weird like. Hi.
Hi.
What's your name? I don't find a way to talk a lot with people.
I'm the type of person that just comes to school, gets my stuff done, and goes home. So I don't really interact with people. I just come to school, get my stuff done, and go home.
When I started taking the theater classes, the classes that pertain to me and my major, that was when I started to really feel at home here. I even joked around saying that I basically live in the theater.
Knowing people's perspective, how they go through their own lives, and then later talk about it, it makes you realize, oh, how is my life actually? You're thinking, I'm living my own life. I see things my own way. But then you realize the other person that's talking, they're alive. When you don't see them, they're still alive doing something else and thinking something else.
The people that I hang out with on a daily basis are definitely the people that I met here. And recently, we went on a trip to LA with some of my theater friends and some of the people that I met here. And we went touring around and we got lost because that campus is huge. Anyways, we were looking for the auditorium and there was this one chick who I guess has never heard of the auditorium before, who's apparently graduated a year before. Excuse me.
Huh?
By any chance, do you know where the auditorium is?
I'm sorry, no.
Oh, that's okay. Wow! Considering the places here in Valley, I'm pretty sure that I know where everything's at. To have already graduated from a big name school like that, and not even know where some of the places were at? It's kind of sad to me.
Then we started talking about religion. We're all technically different religions because he adopted the Muslim religion. I'm a born Catholic. Some of my friends are atheists. And then we got some Judaism, I think. We just feed off of each other, and then learn more about each side.
Those 3 months, like, you could definitely tell it was like a party atmosphere, where if you weren't doing the schoolwork, you're getting fucked up. But here, it's more serious, more goal-oriented.
Fuck!
Oh, that's what I like to hear. Fuck.
What the hell is wrong with both of you?
Oh, come on.
Yo, we're in the moon.
Damn, it's a fucking moon here.
Why aren't you in the moon?
Why is that my
You know, these kids up here, some of them will just shut up. I'm just like,
excuse me, baby. Excuse me, baby. Hi. Don't do that. This is a learning institute. We're trying to learn stuff over here. Okay? You know, there's two different groups. Over here, you got these kids, you know, with their hanging pants, all hanging down, foul mouth, all of that.
Talking shit.
And over here, you know, everybody's getting degrees. So let's go to the writing center, or the success center.
Not a motherfucking
That's all because
you're going
Tracy
the Bell. Your belt is not worth shit.
It's just that weird thing where somebody right now is walking right outside, possibly thinking, I'm going to go eat, go home, and go do something. You hear someone's story, and then you're like, damn, I guess my story of my life is small compared to literally billions of people out there.
Over here in the cafeteria, these kids,
they probably don't even know what algebra is.
And so I'm just like, sweetheart, Benji, do you have any vocabulary a little bit higher than 4-letter words?
Bitch.
Shit face.
Motherfucker, 12 letters.
You know, I want to go into mama mode. But you know, it's not a fighting thing like that, it's just,
man,
respect. Like some of them don't have respect and it pisses me off when they don't. But you know, I just have to learn to say, that's okay. It's not your child.
It just shocks me, especially the people here. We're from the same community, but we're all living it differently. They have their own struggles, their own lives, their own great days, and their own bad days.
I never saw a lot of households where it was your mom, dad, and two kids. Nah, man. There's a mom, maybe a dad. There's grandma, maybe a grandpa. There's the brother that's not doing their thing. The niece and nephew, and two kids. All in one house. We all have to make it come together. It takes strength, patience, persistence. It's definitely not easy. But you know that's what it is. Everybody's so tight-knit that everybody knows everybody. You can go to Colton. You can run into this guy.
Hey, I know this fool! Bassa, man!
Yeah, this is my brother's sister's aunt's cousin. Whatever. That's how it is. Everybody's so tight-knitted that everybody either knows where you're going, who you're coming from, who your family member is. That might not be good sometimes, because you can run into that.
Hey, buddy.
That's a snitch.
What a new family.
He's not right.
Hey, brother, where you going? Can you leave it up, give me some love? Come on.
Me.
Oh my God, look at me. Check this shit out.
What is? Just
don't. Dude! Wait, miss, hold up. Let me check. What is? Dude!
You guys got the tips, but that's good enough.
See you later.
Damn fool if I've ever seen one.
Whatever. That's how this city is.
I mean, I like it here. There's so much diversity. There's so much, I say, potential here as well.
Now since I'm actually here, since I'm actually meeting people and making friends, it's like that old good feeling like we had back in high school.
I meet some really, really good people here. Which is different from the other colleges I went to, which is, well, I'm either isolated or I'm around a whole bunch of stuff I don't really relate to. But here, well, it's just more diverse.
No way.
Yeah. At the autobus, the bus, almost all the people are people who don't have their license. They look weird. They look high. No, they look like, I don't know. People on the bus are weird. There was this time where I saw this girl clipping her toenails. I think the only people that aren't weird are the students.
Yeah, there's some pretty cool people over there. And some pretty interesting people over there as well. I guess you'll never know what to expect when you're walking down the hallways or across the campus.
I enjoy it because I'm learning from all the kids. Because all mine is gone. You know, it's changed and it's different. The music. That's one thing right there.
The play in my song. The butterfly
fly. Okay, y'all need to put y'all headphones on. You know, nowadays these kids listen to her name, that girl with the twerking and the Miley Smiley, you know.
My Cyrus!
Good fucking God.
My grandbabies have been listening to her, and I'm just like, okay, that's you. You know, I don't get it, because we black, you know, black like that, but they don't care. They just do whatever.
I always say, there's something new always to learn about this campus.
And it's not just because of facilities or institutions or anything like that. It's because of the people.
I wish I found some better sounds no one's ever heard. I wish I had a better voice to sing some better words. I wish I found some chords in an order that is new. I wish I didn't have to rhyme every time I sing. I was told when I get older all my fears would shrink, but now I'm insecure and I care what people think.
My name's blurry face and I care what you think. My name's blurry face and I care what you think. Wish we could turn back time.
Something I'm not. I'm in love with art in every shape and form. I love paint, I love clay, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Here, they say I won't even be eligible if I don't pick something off their list. But I have a plan here. Freedom. How can you even call yourself that if you're letting them put you in a category that maybe you might be successful in? I don't need this.
Well, yes, I do. Yams is gonna need a babysitter, and you're too broke. Yeah, you can't afford to pay anyone. Right, so settle. I can't believe she picked out 2 years of my life. Like, I can't change my mind. But I can. Because you know what? I signed a contract. Just be a woman of your word. How can I pick something off the list?
Bread's easy. Settle.
Right. I'll just pick some random major. And that'll be that.
I was stressed out, but pretend give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship and then we'd fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now be laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. We used to pretend give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship.
A typical day at Valley starts for me when I get there between 7:30 and 7:45.
Well, for me, before yesterday was, well, I got out at about 4:30, then I went to work. And,
I have a daughter, and it's hard. Like, she likes to play. She'll get up at 4 in the morning and is like, where's my binky? And I'm like, damn, go back to sleep. But she'll do that, and I'll give her toys. And I'll try to get my homework done. Because when I get home, I try to spend as much time with her as I possibly can. You just can't be like, go away.
I do order picking. So basically, I have a cart, I have a box, I have a little scanner thing, I have an iPad with an RF gun, that's the little scanner. And I have an iPad and it tells me to go to this location and pick out how many you need, click the barcode, click the box, and do that. And you do that for 8 hours, and you stay in one aisle, and you go up and down, I would do it from like 6 to 2:30, sometimes 8 to 4:30, sometimes 2 to 12:30. Basically, I work 8 to 10 hours a day. And then I come here and I type up whatever homework I could. I don't have a computer at home, so I have to come here and type it up or whatever. And then I go to class, and then we do the thing, and then we just go home. It's pretty run of the mill, so to speak. It's just work, school, home. Work, school, home. Work, school,
Yeah, it's profiling. but we know how they look like. So my friend Chris just finished talking on the phone and said,
"Hey, I gotta call you back, okay?"
These guys seen it, and they came up to us and said,
"Hey, little man, let me borrow your phone."
I had my phone in my pocket. I was just thinking, fuck, something's about to go down. Then my friend said,
"No."
And then he said,
"Nah, little man, come on. I just need to make a phone call real quick, you know?"
Blah, 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 blah. Then my friend said,
"No, man, what? No."
Then he said,
"Give me your motherfucking phone. Or I'm gonna blast your ass."
Then he reached down his jeans. I don't know what he's reaching for, probably a gun or something, because it was baggy jeans. I was wearing a baggy jersey during that time. Everybody wore baggy clothing. Then they told us to
turn the fuck around. Get the fuck over.
This happened on Mill Street. The main street. And nobody said anything. Nobody said or saw anything. Eventually they told us to
don't turn around. Don't fucking look back, you hear me?
I then told my friend that we had to turn around. Once we turn around, they're already half a mile down Main Street.
So I'm walking home from school, and there's this guy following me.
Hey,
and I'm just sitting
there
between the
guard them. So I'm walking
really fast with my head down.
Hiding
my sleeve just in case, hoping that I don't have to actually use it. There's nothing particular about this. Just people.
I remember one time, I don't know what was going on, but all I remember was my mom and the neighborhood lady. They were telling all the kids that were playing outside, they were just like, "Get in the house! Let's go!
Because I left my iPod charger on there. I go in. I get my charger. I leave, and his parents are like,
take care of yourself.
I see the two dudes to my left coming. They're wearing these baggy white shirts. They said something to me.
Pussy ass bitch.
I knew that they were talking to me because I recognized them. I'm by myself. So I said, what? I threw my hands up like, what? We're in the front yard of the grass, and one of the dudes comes to my face with nose to nose. He said something to me.
Man, shut the fuck up and do something.
I said something back. Man, get the fuck out of my face, man. Next thing you know, he hits me. He hits me. I hit him back. But I split my pinky at him because I hit him right in his nose. He backed up a little bit and I started to go after him. And that's when I feel the second guy put his arm around my neck. And he's kicking at my knees trying to give me the cold air. The guy I hit came in with like this running in. I was trying to get this guy off me. My sister, she was at my friend at the time. She came down the street screaming like, you can only imagine, you know?
Hey,
eventually,
two of them
ran out.
Get off! Take that shit out of my yard. Beat it!
I ain't full. They didn't give me the full. That was their intention. To just get me to the ground so they could kick me. It didn't take them too long to get caught after that because when they were running, they had blood on their shirts. But since they got caught by the police, they said that I was a rat. And they told their older friends this who were out of high school. And they went around saying, when we catch this fool,
we're gonna kill him.
Yeah, they started throwing death threats at me. And what made things worse is I knew some of the gang members back in elementary school. So they knew where I lived. It was uncomfortable. I lost the whole basketball thing. My mom, she took me out of high school due to the violence and put me into independent studies. That was the beginning of the second semester of my sophomore year.
If you have a passion for something, sometimes you just need someone to ignite it. I remember this one story that my sister was telling me about how she used to drink in class. She'd just say things like,
dude, I'm so fucked.
And I remember this other story about these kids in high school. They were doing coke. Yeah, just straight up coke, right on the desk. And nobody cared. Just, yeah, no one cared. Because anything goes here.
My father was a San Bernardino police officer back in the 80s. And he used to tell me stories of the social stigma of the police department. It was fucked up. He told me this one story of this guy who grew up in San Bernardino and rose to the ranks of drug dealers and gun runners and shit like that. He actually broke one of his cousins out of a county prison one time, but cops didn't charge him because they didn't have proof. Supposedly the story goes is the cops catch him, throw him in the back of the squad car, forcibly shove crack cocaine down his throat until he dies. Yeah, stories like that? Where? I don't know. You've seen the police brutality?
It just kind of happened. You grew up. You saw things. Well, you didn't really see them. You knew about them.
teaching the fundamentals of Catholicism. And recently, we had this huge, breaking, dramatic, almost ulcer my stomach type of thing that happened. And it was just... Let's just say that there were two very clicky people over there. And with our church group, we want to make sure that we are open to everyone so that no one feels excluded, especially the students.
I was overcoming the fear of not knowing exactly what the end game is. You know, when it comes to school, it's like, all right, I got through one semester. All right, another one. We're getting a little closer here. You know what I'm saying? But what are the plans?
Everything I do, I try to do it with love. Okay, Father God, I need you today because it's not easy. Because I've got to be a student, a mother, a wife, and it's hard. It's hard to keep it all balanced.
Now, challenges. Well, excuse my language, but fucking books.
Watch your mouth, boy. Like.
Well, I managed to get through it as a college student. Books, money, and planning were a solidified outcome. Yeah. But as much as college preached to you, you know how they say it. We're here to help you to get to the next step.
We're here to help you to get to the next step.
Yeah, I get it. But you're not here to help me, like in an aspect. You're not gonna sign these applications for me. You're not gonna help donate to my cause. Maybe you might just help me identify what my cause is, but yeah. You're literally gonna put me on this campus door. And what else? You know, that's the challenge.
I was originally gonna ride a bike here from Redlands to San Bernardino, but my bike got stolen on the second day of school. I remember parking it in the middle of campus, and I waited there for an hour, but by the time I got back, it's gone. Well, now I just ride the bus from... I have to get up at 5:30 a.m., catch it on the 6:30, and wait a long-ass time until 8 a.m. But luckily I like to read on the way here. But people in the morning, they're pretty dead. Midday, people are just prone to yell at the bus driver for stuff that's out of their control.
Fucking idiot.
The only thing I think about when I think about school is not being late. Because it's a big campus and I don't even know. I'm so scattered. I tell my mom sometimes in the morning, I have to take my sisters to school, and I won't even know about it until that morning. Yeah, and then sometimes I have to wait to take a shower because someone else is already in there. I like being on time, but I'm a really late person.
I remember this one time, this lady got on the bus. I think it was somewhere near the community hospital. She gets on the bus. Apparently she doesn't have enough money, 75 cents. Bus driver tells her to get off, and she makes this huge argument of why she should be on the bus.
Come on, I gotta go to class now.
Even though she didn't have enough money.
I'm the kind of person that needs like 5 alarms because I won't wake up. If I need to be up by 7, I'll set an alarm clock for like 6. And then I won't wake up for a whole hour, I'm telling you. I put a whole bunch of them afterwards. And then sometimes I forget this is the last alarm. So I kind of just turn it off and sleep in. Yeah, it makes the process a bit shorter. And then, it's like a... Just showering and then 10 to 15 minute drive from here to the school. And then the traffic, especially around 8 o'clock, because the morning classes, there's always traffic.
I'm like, damn, got class right now. I can't be doing this. So she just says,
I'm a veteran. You cannot treat me. You can't treat me this way. You know all I've done for this country? I'm getting on this bus.
Realizes he's not gonna win this. So, drives off.
I needed to bring something. I'm just trying to remember everything.
One time in San Bernardino, a friend and I attended a party during which he got shot up. Everyone ran to the backyard to hop the back fence, but we still tried out front barbed wire. So while everyone ran around looking for another exit, I lit up what I thought would be my last blunt.
Well, I'm not about to die, so come on.
So as gunshots continued, fucking smoked. Luckily, all went back to normal. I partied for a while.
Sheriff's department, right here on the corner. And one day, I was hanging out with my friend, and they were taking out a body on a stretcher with a tarp over it. I honestly didn't even notice until my friend said something about it.
Hey, I think they're carrying off a dead body.
You think?
His eyes are closed.
It didn't necessarily faze me. I mean, you hardly hear about the deaths in the cities because they just happen so often that it's almost a commodity.
One time, Possum got locked in a store. And we had to go all the way over there at 2 o'clock in the morning to the pizza guy next door. We knew it. He was like,
Hey, I think there's somebody in your store.
Okay, so we went all the way over there and it was a possum. Hey, kids, feel!
I'm still learning as I go along. I wasn't a perfect mother, damn it.
I graduated when I was 17, and I had my son when I was 16, the year before I graduated. So, with baby growing up, I wasn't perfect in doing him. I mean, I always had a good job and making money, but I would spend it on drinking, gambling, smoking, getting high. I would go up, and then I'd get down. Then I went back to high. You know, I've been homeless, on the streets, you know, living on the streets, whatever. I've been all that, did all that. Yeah, I've been homeless on the streets. Them streets ain't nothing to play with. But like I tell them, I'm not afraid to tell my story. I don't want your story to sound like mine. You get out there, you see them people homeless, up under bridges and shit. You know, one of the counselors, she was like,
Miss Tina, I never would have thought.
I'm like, mm-hmm, yeah, girl. It went from being a social drug, to smoking on a regular, to selling. Then once you started using your product, you know, you can't use what you sell. It don't work. It'll never work out. So now you're just selling. You're selling so you can get enough money so you can recoup and get some more. It's like, once you try it. Hey!
You have credits?
No. Then that feeling is like, oh my God, it's like you're having sex, and I'm like, hey, can I get some more of that? Can I? And then now you're chasing it. You don't never get it again, but you chase it, and you chase it till you say when. Now, I was one of those, what do you call it, functioning addicts. I could go to work, go to school, come home, get high, take care of the kids, get them settled, put them to bed, they'll go to bed, and then I'll sit, drink, maybe talk on the phone with my friend, you know, next day do my 8 hours, whatever. But now I see where most of the problem is drugs, and there's a lot of mental people. They closed down this mental hospital, and now the mental people are just out there, and the people on drugs don't give a damn about the mental people because they got money. You know, you're mentaling, so you get a check.
Hey, buddy.
Hey.
Let me see what you got. I want everything. We're going to be best friends.
Befriended him and everything. Like I said, those streets ain't nothing nice and they don't play with you. You think you're invincible, but you're not.
One time, there was this really drunk old man who was yelling at me because I didn't have any fish.
Fish?
Or something like that. A lot of the times, because my mom owned the party supply store, she'd leave me here. I'd have to watch it. She leave me here with the lady who didn't speak any English. She was a cook. I was 12 behind the cash register trying to get everything done. I didn't know how to deal with this man that was yelling at me because I didn't have any fish. And he was nasty because he'd spit.
Self-destructive for both of us. I got scars on my neck. If you can still see them right here. Look, I promised myself I wasn't gonna be self-destructive to myself or to anyone else. I got to drop it. I have to drop it. Even though it does break my heart. But I have to face reality.
One time, a lady just ran into the restroom.
fall. I think it was somewhere in October. For those 3 months, it just felt like a continuous spiral. I kept isolating myself from my friends, my family. I just kept on drinking all day, every day. Until one night, I reached the political point where I get into a fight with the president. Not called your friends because you get fucked up together. That doesn't make friends. So I get into a fight with them, and I leave all pissed off, and that's all I remember that night. Then I wake up the next morning, and just continued where I left off. Ferociously hungover, I just kept on drinking, hoping it would help. But nothing to do, no job, no school. Just kept on drinking. Trying to kill myself that night. Every intention to. But a lot of thought really went into that. I was so surprised to wake up the next morning. At that time, I realized why I did it. I thought it was a failure. To think I was such a failure.
So 9 o'clock in. I clock out. I head over to the apartment. And the apartment's up these flights of stairs. Yo, open up, man. Come on, you know what time it is. What's up?
Hey.
When I got there, everybody seemed a bit uneased. So I asked, what the fuck is going on?
Okay, listen. There's these three guys showed up. These three black guys. But anyways, no one knows who they are. They were just, you know, they came here and they just started eating all the food and drinking all the beer.
I found out that this girl brought the nobody knew who they were, and nobody recognized them. Apparently, they kicked them out like,
hey, you guys have got to get out.
Yeah, they did not want to leave, so they had to force them out like,
hey, you guys, get the fuck out of my house!
The dude that kicked them out, he came and told me.
Hey, so, I'm all right. Guys, listen, they said something about possibly coming back, but whatever.
Whatever?
Yeah, whatever.
Whatever?
What the fuck ever? Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally sure. Yeah, come on.
So that was at 9. Right, right. After that, we were chilling, playing some beer pong, smoked some weed.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny, because we're 20-year-olds, we're playing Super Smash Bros. It's a Nintendo game. Chillin'.
good people, good vibes. Then something hits the door. Loud. So loud that the windows rattled. And everybody was like, what the fuck was that? Everybody shut up. Everybody stopped. And everybody looked at each other. And didn't you say those guys were gonna come back?
Fuck.
He opens the door. He opens it. He cracks it. He looks. And there's nobody there. He closes it and he says,
listen, no one's out there. No one's out there.
But my friend Sean, being as prideful as he is, says,
now fuck that!
What? Dude.
Come on, fuck that.
He goes rushing down the stairs. It's my best friend, so I can't let him go alone.
Bring him back safely, please.
You're halfway down the stairs. And I took a look and I saw what looks like a shadow. Three people. Side by side. It's dark. It's midnight. Took a closer look and I saw what looked like a baseball bat on one of the dude's sides. I don't know. Something told me. That's a gun. My conscience? I don't know, God. But something told me that's a gun. Now you can get back upstairs. And that's what I did. Beginning about my best friend, who I just left down
with. Yo, close the fucking door.
Close the door, I got a gun.
Dude, what?
Get
it quick. Fuck off.
Fuck! Sean is still down there. Open the door, man. He opens it. Go. Then that's what I'm doing. It sounded like a gunshot. I look back at the stairs. Up there. The shawl is still down. And there he is. He's unconscious. And there was nobody around him. He was in this S shit. It was so moving. I got to Sean. Sean! I have his head. I'm looking at his eyes. And they're half closed. I shake him. Come on, Sean. Wake up, man. Open your eyes, man! He's not responsive. Finally, I start screaming. So I call 911! So I help! Please! Help!
Oh my God!
People started coming down. I was there right here.
What
are you
doing? I don't know.
I'll be okay, man, okay? Just listen to me. Help me! The girl came and grabbed the leg and everything.
We're moving on.
Just trying to get him to my car, then RA. She came out screaming.
Don't move it! Don't move it!
What the hell are you doing?
Call 911!
She knows what she's doing. She's in there.
So somebody called an ambulance. Sean, sorry, man. Fuck, I'm sorry, man! I was supposed to go there with you, man! Fuck! I'm still screaming. Never screamed like that before in my life. I was right there. And I looked at his eyes. It looked soulless. Black. Yo, I think Matt is fucking dead, man.
What?
No.
What do you mean? No, bro. Come on, man. They're not dead.
I was right there the whole time.
Come on.
Yeah. And it even looked like he started coming to a little bit.
He's breathing.
He is?
Yeah, he's breathing.
Oh, my God.
Okay. Thank God.
He's still alive.
Yeah. I don't see any blood, man.
Good.
What? What's going on? I ain't noticed I had blood on my face. so out of it at the time. So then the cops came. The ambulance came. The next up. Oh, Sean was dead. Sean, I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry, Sean. We went to the hospital, and we were there all morning. The nurse, she came out and told me,
go home. Go get some rest. Come back tomorrow. Go. Go.
So I head home. Thank you. All right. He's in the hospital. He has to be all right. Right? So after I get some rest, I head back over to the hospital. While I'm on my way, the nurse, she called me. How is it?
Bad news.
Okay, what bad news?
He has pneumonia, and he's paralyzed from the waist down. It doesn't look good. If you guys went to move him, he'd probably still be walking.
When she said that, I had to pull over. I was crying. We were supposed to go to the gym that night. But this shit was supposed to happen. It was horrible. And finally I got there. Say the end of September. His birthday is September 13th. It happened August 9th. He's still alive. But he's still paralyzed. This year we'll make it 6 years. And what pisses me off the most is that the shooter was wearing a mask. So we didn't get any time. I'm up there with Stan, giving my testimony, testifying, telling them, this is the guy. I know who it is. And everything about him, the way he looked, the way he acted, everything about him just said,
I'm the one who did it. And I'm not going to jail for it.
That burned me inside. And all I wanted to do was kill him. There's three of you and one of him. Why? Why? You could have just beat his ass and been on your way. Why did you have to shoot him? So the verdict came in and he was proven not guilty. One of the guys confessed to the crime in the interrogation room. So he got about 10 years. So at least somebody got something. That's the worst night of my life. After that, just think. You
something. Even if you don't know what it is yet.
Stage of denial until I just finally realized I'm gone. It actually happened. I remember going to the funeral. And seeing all these faces. We're all connected by him. We all have a story because of him. You know?
no one noticed? Why would he write these numbers over and over? Why? And he hung out with a certain kind of group. That would be more obvious than that. But I didn't want to say I kind of figured it out because I was only like 12. He went to jail 3 times. He had to go on probation, kicked out of school. He was always in jail. We had to sign papers to get him out, but she didn't know what to do. She was always like, well, my ass has F1. I'll just sign it for you. I'd do stuff like that for my mom. I'd watch my little sister, she's only 2 years younger than me. But when they would go to his court cases, I did that for my mom. I'd watch her sign. I did that. He liked this one movie, East LA Kings or something like that. It was really ghetto. I guess gangbanger who got sent to jail for selling drugs or something like that. And it was based on a true story. It was a certain gang. He was like,
oh, one of the gang members of that gang lived down the street.
Why would you tell me that? I was like, is it all true?
Yeah. Like, yeah. It's all true.
I got scared. He went to jail. And the mom had the little boy while he was in jail. The little boy kind of grew up bad with the gang. But he didn't really get involved. He lived with the mom's mom. And the stepdad that the mom only married to get papers to become a citizen. And he would rape the mom. One time, he drugged her and he just raped her. And he would beat the grandma. That sweet old lady, she got caught in a bread store. And we go to a bread store that looks just like that. There was this one story that made me like, hey. I got sad. It made me not like the police. I got angry. It was about this one family, immigrant family. They got, well, it was found that they didn't have papers. And so the police would just come in and deport them and arrest them and just take them away. And they're like big assholes.
Abre la puerta!
Hi, boy.
Policía!
The girl, she was 18. She was in the shower. And they just dragged her out. And she was like, we lived here. For 10 years. We pay our taxes. We don't do anything wrong.
Come on!
I've never gotten in trouble.
Thank you.
times.
I started school when I was 18, like right out of high school. And yeah, I just went to school and did what people told me to do. They were just like,
go to school.
Get your education.
You're smart.
Go to school.
Get an education.
You're smart.
And I didn't really have the money at the time, and I was just so stressed, so I came here. And yeah, I took a bunch of classes. Like, you know, math and history and science. And I didn't really know what I wanted to do here, but I would get good grades. I got an associate's degree from here. I didn't really have anybody from school or life or in general ever tell me something like, you know, hey, why don't you try acting? Or why don't you try, well, you don't really seem happy doing what you're doing now, so why don't you just, I don't know. And I have to work now just because my dad doesn't want to do it anymore. I have to support myself. He's just like,
it's been long enough. Gotta get a job.
So I'm like, all right. And I just quit my job. Yesterday, I just quit because it was a terrible, terrible job. We would just run up and down the aisles and get paid minimum wage. It was the most undignifying goddamn thing I ever did. I've seen a grown man run through the aisles just to make a 19-second quota time. I'm just like, dude, you're being paid minimum wage. Like, chill. Because honestly, we should all be slowing down. We should all just be like, if you want us to work this hard, at least give us like $12 an hour. But no, they don't want that, because they're illegal immigrants, and they're grateful for whatever they can get, because back in Mexico, they're gonna get their fucking heads chopped off, man, so this is goddamn paradise for them. And it's at a new warehouse, and we had this guy, I don't really remember what his name was, he was like Canadian or Moravian or whatever, he came down here. And he was always, like, just yelling at us for stuff that wasn't even our fault. You know, on a temp worker, he would just say things like,
hey, buddy, you know I don't have the workforce nor the manpower to keep up with all this business that I'm getting?
Yeah, he'd just say things, even like,
and it's so unfortunate that I have to turn down business.
I'm just like, I don't give a shit, dude. You're paying me $10.15 an hour. Just tell me what you want me to do and I'll do it. You know? Because he doesn't have to pretend like he's my friend. He doesn't even have to pretend like I work for him. Because I don't. I'm a temp. You know what that means? That means temporary. That means he doesn't have to worry about insurance or the 401k or helping me out with retirement. You don't give a shit about me! And he did say that.
I don't give a shit about you.
Yeah, he just said that. He just let it slip. Because he just, like, suddenly got really angry and was ranting at me, like,
there was always an excuse for you. I do not care.
He just said,
and I don't care that you go to school!
And when he said that, I lost my shit. I was just like, this guy, he doesn't give a shit about me. He doesn't give a shit about the fact that I go to school. And yet, he expects me to break my back for him. So I'm just like, you know what? I'm 23 years old. I'm still in my early 20s. I can make bad decisions. So then,
I decided that I was going to make a bad decision today. And I just quit. I just quit. Really bad, too. I started going slow after that meeting. I was just like, I am gonna get fucking fired today. He was just yelling at the rest of those guys like,
hey, you gotta get your quotas up.
¿Qué pasó?
¿Qué?
Tienes que mantener tus cuotas arriba de posición.
Thank you.
I've read the narrative of Frederick Douglass. He basically said, change does not come willingly. You have to force the change. And, well, the people in power, they don't want the change, you know? In a lot of ways, those are my father figures. You know, they're the people that I strive to be. And they don't tell you, well, my history teacher, he was fantastic, like, aces all the way. So, yeah, I would say he helped me out with that, you know, opened the door to that for me. But even so, a lot of those things that I did them on my own. I had to find success or just take it myself. And that's exactly what I do. I mean, sure, it's probably the reason why a lot of people don't like me. But fine, you know, because it's my method. Works for me.
So I asked them all the same question, you know. What do you want to be when you grow up? He said he wanted to be a cashier, so I'm like, okay. I was driving and I looked in the rearview mirror and I was just like, a cashier? So what kind of house do you want to live in? Do you want to live with mama or do you want to get your own place, you know? What do you want to do?
I want to be a cashier.
I said, why do you want to be a cashier?
Because they make all the money.
Now he's looking at when he goes into the store and he sees the cashier getting all the money, he thinks that that's their money. So I was like, okay, but baby, do you know that when you're a cashier that you don't get all the money? The money goes to the people who own the store.
I'm not the type of person that likes to dwell on the negative things that happen in life. They're inescapable. They're gonna happen regardless, and the only thing that I believe that I can try to do is just be that one person. Those few people in the world that just tries to spread the optimism.
I look back at it now like, damn, someone tried to set my mom's pinata on fire. I think of my mom really. She was always so stressed, just working every day, all day, and weekends. And then my grandpa died. It just got worse. I don't want to work that much and not make that much money. I want to work in a nicer area, safe. If I have kids, I don't want them growing up in a place like that. That's what I think about when I'm at school.
I got two little sisters, and they look up to me. And knowing that I, I just can't lose. I got these two little girls and my mom. That's all I got. I don't really know my pops like that, which makes me another statistic. But I'm not gonna let that define me. I let it define me for 22 years of my life. Now I just gotta look out for my two little sisters and my mom. I can't be foolish. I can't.
Yad mi turno. It's my turn. I have to take the next step. I'm here. For me, success is learn English very good, get a doctorate, you know, have my own enterprise, a corporation. My parents always tell me to think one step forward than the others. So like, if the teacher tells you, bring me an essay of 5 pages, okay, I'll do 7. You know, I took them in salary from my parents. My grandparents, well, they were farmers. But they wanted a better quality of life. So he came here to the United States. The daughter of my grandpa, my mother, well, my parents were also farmers. But they studied. We're doing fine now because of that. Now, my mom has a master's degree in business. My dad, he has a master's degree in education.
As far as consistently going to college and trying to get a degree, I'm probably gonna be one of the first of my siblings to do that. It's definitely something that pushes me towards it. And my grandma, she's the one who's helping me pay for college. And I don't want to screw around with the money that she's so generously giving me to do so. Thank you. That's pretty much it.
I come from a broken home. My mom's a single mother. My dad moved to Oregon when I was 10. My mom was the secretary at Melinda University. She started working there when I was 4. She would leave. She would be gone all the time. She'd leave at 6 in the morning. My grandma, she would take me to school. My mom didn't get home until 7:30 at night. To me, I thought, if my mom is doing all of this, then I have to do my part, and I have to bring in the grades. And I have to do it well. My mom was around all these people that went to school, got degrees, and they motivated her to go back to school, to pursue nursing. And she did. Now she's a nurse, an RN. She's been on the ICU for 10 years. Seeing her do that, being from here, the same exact place, she probably walked these halls just as you and I, here. That told me it can be done. Or you can run away like my dad did when he moved to Oregon. I love my dad. We have a close relationship still, but he ran away. He thought he couldn't do it. Too many drugs. Much temptation, adultery, that broke my family. So my dad chose one way. My mom chose another. My dad works in a mill, breaking his back every day. My mom, she works in the ICU, making $40 to $50 an hour. So I see both. And just because you leave does not mean things are going to get better. So you can change yourself to better everyone else around you. Because that is what my mom did. She paved the way for me. Her being able to do what she did. Being from here. That is what literally keeps me going. And now I just want to help everybody else here. Because if I do something, being from here, San Bernardino, that puts it on the map.
There was just something about that day where it just felt like everything was going to shit. Then I get into this theater class and I perform a scene. Well, it just felt so therapeutic in a way. It made me forget all of the stress and the worries and all the bullshit that's happened in my life.
Look, I had to drop the relationship. Even though it did break my heart. But it's like, you know what? We're not good for each other. That was the first stage. The second was empowerment. I had to empower myself through my mind. Now, I want to go back to school. But I want to be in theater arts. I want to write, direct, act, and all of that. And it's not just a dream. It's not even to be braggadocious. To me, this is going to be reality. Now, third, I can't just leave it all up in here. I have to put it out there, put out the work. It's gonna take time, but I can do it.
We're only here for a matter of time. And during that time, you should be learning. And when you get to where you wanna go, you can look back and be like, man, I hated it because it just sucked. Trust me, I can relate. I worked at Stater Brothers for 6 long years. To be honest, every day, I hated it.
But it did teach.
take responsibility for your own mistakes.
I wake up every morning and move about. I try so hard to forget the bullshit that happens in my life. And yet it just disappears and gets back going again. I don't know. I guess it's one of the main reasons why I stay busy. I just don't want to give myself time to think.
Can I be honest? I'm stressed out. I live with my moms. Nothing's going for me. I got fired twice. I have no financials. No financials to speak of. I'm broke, and nothing's going for me. So I decided to take time. But my way, I have to get down and pray. Pray. Now, praying, it doesn't work like those movies where a miracle happens right after a day. No, I had to roam around. I had to make moves. I had to do something. So one day I'm out with my family and my moms. And I see Barnes & Noble. And I'm like, hey, I need a book. So I go to the autobiography section, and I start looking around. M's. Now there's a book I need. M's, M's, M's. I find it. The autobiography of Malcolm X. You know, I only have 20 bucks, but you know what? I was like, you know, fuck it. Keep the change. I went home, I opened the book, and I just dug into it. I started reading page after page, chapter after chapter, and deeper I got into it. I got more confident. I know what I like, and I know what I don't like. I always consider myself black, but being in America, it's like easy. You know, you're black. But reading this, it was like Malcolm was telling me, you are more than capable, even though you're black. It was like he was talking to me. He was telling me that you need to rise up. You need to be a man. You need to do for your own, for your brothers and sisters as you're supposed to. You know how some people get the Holy Ghost? Well, this is my Holy Ghost. And I had to spread the word. And I had to tell people. It's like this country, it wants you to get drunk as a pigeon. It wants you to be stupid and not do anything, kill each other and sell dope. But it's more than that. I got to the end of the book, and it was sad because he died. But he knew what he was dying for. And I had to face reality. I have to know what I have to live for.
Afterwards, I was like, damn. We're all connected, buddy. I was just thinking of the times we had. Moments I wish I was with him more.
I always want a better quality, a better environment for me and my family. That is a good motivation for me. I am my motivation.
You don't. You gotta make it for yourself, okay?
It's a dog-eat-dog world out there. You either kill or be killed. You gotta find success by looking for it. By reading.
Optimism. Optimism is going to be the key to getting you out of all of this mess. That negativity that you have has to be done with. It has to be positive. And if you just take a look at the optimistic side of things in life and have an understanding, then maybe, just
fucking maybe it would make this city better.
You realize there is no grand scheme of things. We're all isolated here. There's no rhythm, no rhyme, no reason. You can pretty much do or take whatever you want. You just have to find the goal. And that's the hard part. I guess it means happiness. I guess it means change, optimism. All of those things that separates us from the bullshit in life.
That moment of clarity is like, you know what? They're looking at you. So I decided that I wasn't gonna embarrass my babies anymore. Because I could tell, you know. They were doing some Black History Month something. So I decided to show up at the school, and you know, I was drinking. And I'm like, hey baby!
Some people are just kind of floating around in the dark. I know, because I've been asking myself the question, what the hell do I even want to do? You always wanted to pursue acting. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to go walk in that building, and I'm going to do it. And that set the tone for me. Audition. Now I'm involved with the theater. At first, it did take up a lot of my time. Like a lot. It's a struggle. And you have to have willpower. And that came as I learned. And the more I learned, the more I got involved. Taking classes, 2 units here and 3 units there, I realized that it was all worth it.
The state people should give more funding to the schools because they made me the man that I am today, and it was fantastic. They taught me to teach myself, and they taught me that not everybody's going to like me or my ideas, and that's okay too. Same thing with Ray Kroc, you know? Everyone looked at him, the guy who made the McDonald's franchise. You know, I really like Ray Kroc. And I really like the brothers who came up with that assembly line production for making food. Like, come on, those are great ideas. No, those are revolutionary ideas. Because it's just like, god damn, you know, that's America right there. That is, it really is.
There was always this one moment where it actually almost brought tears to my eyes. I was leading some of the kids on a hike, and the rest of them, they stayed inside. And just out of nowhere, when we were walking back from the hike, because they were calling us for the past 10 minutes to come back. And when we got there, all I heard was clapping. And then,
positive, no matter how bad it is. Life isn't fair, but once you find out what your purpose in life is, your positivity will be the only thing that stands true.
And I'm given a bad label? Most of the time, I know it's not true, so I just don't care or put energy into it. My goal in life is not to prove anything to anyone. So when I'm given a bad label, just keep on doing what I'm doing.
Thank you for looking past all the ugliness. It takes a lot to try to find the beauty behind all this, and it is here.
Things need to get done here, though. Focusing on the good,
yeah.
But that isn't going to change things.
And I realize life's not over, it's a new day!
Jesus. this is for him. You do it, this is tough now. You feel like giving up now. This bar is tough now. But how can you learn if you don't fall? I can't even walk if first you don't fall. But through it all, you keep blessing me while they're pressing me. And they're testing me. They keep stressing me. Because they never heard a preacher show. Show, yeah, go.
Saturday crowd, huh? How about this performance, huh? Yeah! All right, man. My name is Isaac Fonish. I'm the assistant director for the show. And on behalf of the cast and crew, we want to say thank you so much for coming out and supporting SBVC Theater Arts Department. It really means so much to us that you guys came out, taking the time out of your busy schedules. And also, I'm not sure if you're aware, but Operation New Hope is in the building tonight. Yeah. All right. If you aren't familiar with Operation New Hope, they're an organization that really helps and strives to make a difference in our community by really acknowledging the struggles that which you witness here on this stage tonight. So if you have a moment, you can check them out right there in the lobby on your way out. But with that being said, I want to go ahead and give this generous donation from an anonymous donor to Operation New Hope. Once again, thank you so much. We really appreciate everything you do for us. All right. Let's go ahead and get a good one. All right. Let's end this off with some dance, y'all. Yeah.